All right, so here we are, Forces of Motion. This is the second study guide. Don't get this confused with the other study guide that I gave you the other day. Although, Catlett, that study guide that you had from the other night, don't get rid of it, because I only put like one or two motion graphs in this study guide. I figured we just literally did a quiz where we had like an 80 and above average for most people on the quiz. Why would I give you five or six motion graphs again when we literally just finished that? So I kind of knocked that down and put the rest of them back up there. Make sense? All right. So let's all take a look at number one. Number one. A rocket is traveling towards space. What force must a rocket act against as it moves away from Earth? Now, hopefully no one has forgotten this, but what is a force? What is a force, Miller? Okay, so what push or pull is a rocket acting against as it moves away from Earth? Now, inertia is not a force, is it? Inertia is the tendency of an object to sit still or stay in motion. Gravity is a force, and gravity pulls you towards Earth. I mean, if I'm taking the test, I'm thinking, boy, that sure is an awesome answer. Magnetism is not the answer. How do we know magnetism is not the answer, at least in my class? How do I know that's not the answer? We haven't taught that. We haven't talked about that. Momentum. We talked about momentum, right? As the roller coaster goes down the hill, it picks up more and more momentum, and the bigger the object is, the more momentum it gets going down the hill, the harder it is to fight. That has nothing to do with a rocket, does it? So should anybody miss number one? I mean, I think number one is one of those things that's super easy if we were taking the test. Questions about number one? I didn't think there would be a whole lot of questions going on about number one. Because that's actually kind of easy, to be honest with you. Number two, a student is comparing the amount of force used by his classmates to push a toy car down a ramp. We've done this in class, right? We put toy cars at the top of a ramp. What's the best way to compare the force? Okay, should we A, measure the distance each time the car comes to a stop? So we push it down the ramp and we measure where the car stops. Would that help me out with how hard that I push something? Okay, so people are saying no to this one. Measure the amount of time it takes the car to travel down the ramp. That's not a terrible answer, is it? Remember, we're looking for the best way, so you know they're going to throw a couple good answers in there. That one's maybe. I'm going to put a question mark if I can draw a question mark on the thing here. Measure the distance the car travels with each push. How far the car goes. I'm digging that one. I'm going to compare that to the other one, but I'm kind of liking that. Measure the amount of time it takes for the car to come to a stop. Again, I don't think that's a terrible answer, but what is our best answer?
C.
You guys think C? Check your answer. Look at the back. That's why I have those answers there, to check ourselves. What does the back say? Number two, C is the best answer.
C?
Do we all understand why C is the best answer?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, be careful. But again, that's why we have this study guide, so you can have, if you have questions, like raise those. And if it's something simple, oh, I just looked at the wrong answer, then we're good to move on, right? All right, everybody feeling good, one and two? I'm not stressing this test. I think we're ready. I really do. I think people in here are ready for this test. Alan is pushing a car across three different surfaces. I'm already starting to think in my head, all right, three different surfaces. They're going to do something to those three different surfaces, aren't they? Because that's what we did in class. He pushes the car across a wooden floor, a tile floor, and a carpeted floor. Before I even move on, kids, what do you think is going to happen? Where's the car going to move the slowest between a wooden floor, a tile floor, and a carpeted floor, Sean? Why is the carpeted floor going to move slower? It has more friction. He notices it's harder to push the toy car across the carpeted floor. Oh, wow, we just talked about that. What is the most likely reason? Remember, there might be more than one good answer. It's hardest to push it across the carpet. The car has more mass when it's on the carpet.
No.
No, boys and girls. If we gained mass when we were on carpet, everybody would have tile in their house because you would weigh less on the tile. Right? Hey, I'm going to lose some weight at Christmas this year. I'm going to take the carpet out and put in tile, have less mass. It doesn't work that way. Right? That's not how things work. It would be nice if it worked that way, but that's not how it works. The carpet creates more friction. That sounds exactly like what Sean just said, doesn't it? It's going to have to be an amazing answer to beat that. The car is affected most by gravity on the carpeted floor.
No.
Is gravity any different on carpet versus tile and wood?
No.
No, it's pulling on you the same. The carpet pushes more against the car than other surfaces.
No.
Yeah. A little, but that's not the best answer, is it? I think the best answer is B. And again, you can turn to the back and check because I give you the answer key for that reason. Feeling good? I'm feeling really good. We actually watched a video of this, those kids in England when they did this. I remember the video. I think it was a boy and a girl, though. But Nick and Mike are facing each other on skateboards. They touch palms and push. What describes their movement? If I'm standing on a skateboard and someone else is standing on the skateboard, and we're assuming that the skateboards are facing a certain direction, not sideways, would neither Nick or Mike move? That doesn't make sense to me. Even on a skateboard that was facing the wrong way where the wheels don't move, if I push to get someone else, it would probably knock me off the board and knock him off the board, right? So we would be moving. So that can't be the right answer. Nick and Mike will move backwards away from each other. Somebody said that's a pretty good answer. I would agree. I think that's what happened in the video. Nick will move forward and Mike will move backwards in the same direction.
I don't think
that would work. Nick will move backward and Mike will move forward, which is just the opposite of what that just said. And we all look at that one and say, that doesn't make any sense at all to have one person moving forward and one person moving backwards. So we get a pretty easy answer, a B. Check it. Looking good? Right answer?
Yep.
It is the right answer. As we move on, I get to this point of the test. And Bella, there's something that should click in my head. Okay, we're about to do this today with our ugly sweaters to kind of really reinforce this, which is the big reason why we're doing the ugly sweaters today. I see this kind of question. You immediately think, I should draw a DST triangle. Okay, I see this and I'm thinking that's a DST question, right? So I throw my DST triangle on here. Not easy to do with a mouse, but we're doing our best. DST. Better than writing upside down with my small groups in the morning. 100 meters. Where would that go? 100 meters. Distance. 100 meters. Thank you, Marley, for raising your hand. Okay. 20 seconds. Where would I put 20 seconds? Time. Thank you for raising your hand, sir. So remember, that's 20 seconds. Sometimes they have those weird questions where they mess with us. It makes it change from minutes to seconds or seconds to minutes. And we might have those, but we'll see. What do I do when I see two numbers that are over top of each other like this in a DST triangle, Callie? I'm dividing. So my problem should look like 100 divided by 20. In class, how many times will 20 go into 100?
Five
times. So my answer is B. DST triangle. Hasn't failed us yet, has it? So if you're listening, mean lady who yelled at me in college, it's still working. Still working. Come yell at me now. Right? Don't come yell at me now. I've got children in here. That would not be fun. All right. I'm looking at number 6. When you look at number 6, what's the first thing that comes to your mind, Christian? I better draw a DST triangle again. Do you think there's going to be some of these on the test? You know there's going to be some of these on the test. When I draw my DST triangle, I have 420 kilometers. Where would I put 420 kilometers? Where would I put 420 kilometers, Colton?
Distance.
That is under distance. Mr. Bullens, I don't see another number in there. What do I do, Wesley? What do I do? I don't see a number, an actual number. Do what? A car traveled 420 kilometers in 7 hours. How far did the car travel in 3 hours? I don't see a number. What do I do? It's definitely not three. That comes later. Cabot. In 7 hours. Okay. And if we do 420 divided by seven, not six, 60. Because you have to bring this zero down and divide into it. Now, 60 is an answer, correct?
It isn't the right answer.
I don't think it's the correct answer because it goes 60 kilometers per hour. 60 kilometers per hour. We're not reading the last part. This answer on here is here to trick you. It asks you not what's the average speed, how far did the car travel in 3 hours. Oh, so 60 times 3 is
180.
Mr. Bullens, that's a tricky question. It sure is. That is a tricky question, isn't it? You have to read the entire question. And I love the fact that Wesley said, you haven't read the whole question. And then someone else said, you're still not reading the whole question. Be careful on those. Those are very tricky, all right? Very, very tricky questions when you have multi-step questions. And you know that. Miss Levy's taught you that multi-step questions are the hardest. They're the hardest things you do in math, aren't they?
Yeah.
Well, they're the hardest thing we're going to do on here. So just keep your eye out for that tomorrow, okay? Keep your eye out for that tomorrow. Next, I'm seeing a bunch of numbers, and it even tells me this. When I see this in a thing, I'm most definitely drawing a DST triangle.
So what
180, yes, was the last one. I have students hiked at a rate of 4 kilometers per hour. Where does that go? 4 kilometers per hour. That is definitely not distance. That is speed. 4 kilometers per hour for 4 hours. Well, that goes under time. I do something different, Alana, when they're beside each other. What do? I multiply. 4 times 4? How far did they go? They went 16 kilometers. Feeling good? Who's stressing the test? Who's thinking, good grief, give us the thing today? Like, I'm ready for it. Yeah, give it to me now, Mr. Bullens. I'm ready. Because I knocked the thing out yesterday. I'm ready for this thing. Let's move on. And I think you guys are so ready. You guys have done a great job with motion graphs. I loved this question on the test because people looked at me like I had 6 heads when I put this on the test. And it's like the easiest question in the entire world. It's just funny. Moving at 60, whoa, not the whole thing, Mr. Bullens. Moving at 60 miles per hour. Well, where do I put 60 miles per hour, kiddos? 60 miles per hour goes in speed. For 1 hour, where does that go? Time. What's the distance?
60.
Sorry about that interruption from the office. But boys and girls, 60 times 1 is 60. If you're going 60 miles an hour and you only drive an hour, you go 60 miles. If you're going 45 miles an hour and you only drive an hour, you're going to go 45. I mean, that's an easy one, right? Don't let that one trick you. So we've done half of the thing. You guys feel good about that?
Yeah.
All right.